¿Rocío? ¿Se escucha? Ya. Estimada comunidad académica, profesores, profesoras, estudiantes, estimadas y estimados amigos que nos acompañan de forma presencial y virtual, les doy la bienvenida a la última conferencia de la Cátedra DOTI de ese año 2022. La primera, como algunos recordarán, fue impartida por el profesor Patricio Mena, presente nuevamente en el Instituto de Filosofía. La Cátedra DOTI está destinada a abrir la filosofía a la reflexión pública y al intercambio entre los miembros de la comunidad académica. Se inicia así cada curso del Magíster en Pensamiento Contemporáneo con una clase magistral abierta al público. Hoy se da inicio al curso impartido por la profesora Rocío Garcés sobre normatividad y territorio. Y para iniciar ese curso, tenemos el honor de poder contar con una conferencia del profesor Anthony Steinbock titulada El significado de la filosofía generativa. Me alegro muchísimo de que podamos contar hoy con esa conferencia que presenta un gran interés para el curso, para el programa de Magíster en Pensamiento Contemporáneo y para el Instituto. Como ya se dijo en la mañana, la fenomenología generativa ofrece nuevas perspectivas sobre el problema de lo trascendental y permite aproximaciones, a mi juicio inauditas, extremadamente interesantes sobre la articulación entre la historia, lo social y la filosofía. Asimismo, quiero nuevamente agradecer al profesor Steinbock por su disponibilidad y a la profesora Rocío Garcés por todo el esfuerzo hecho para llevar a cabo esa actividad. Me gustaría señalar que esa actividad forma parte de la celebración de los 40 años de la Universidad Diego Portales. En ese marco, hemos podido escuchar o recibir a importantes filósofos, filósofas, escritoras, como Judith Butler, Elizabeth Anderson, Siri Usved, que está de hecho aquí en ese momento. El apoyo a la filosofía, al ejercicio crítico que requiere y que es su esencia, es indudablemente parte del proyecto de la Universidad Diego Portales. Eso paradójicamente posibilita distancia crítica y compromisos con los lugares donde nos encontramos y que vamos construyendo. Ese coloquio sobre fenomenología y generatividad y el trabajo del profesor Steinbock, central para ese coloquio, posibilita un nuevo trabajo crítico sobre la crítica y nos permite, creo, reflexionar sobre el presente y el futuro, ampliando el marco de la constitución del sentido y abriendo nuevas articulaciones, en particular entre lo genético y lo generativo. Asimismo, además del interés teórico que representan las conferencias que hemos escuchado hasta ahora, ese trabajo que se está haciendo desde la mañana nos vincula, me parece, al aquí y ahora de una manera muy singular y creo muy virtuosa. Espero que eso sea solo el inicio de un trabajo sobre fenomenología y generatividad y de una colaboración muy prometedora con el profesor Steinbock, a quien reitero mis agradecimientos por su presencia. Voy a dar entonces algunas palabras de presentación del profesor. El profesor Anthony Steinbock es académico en la Stony Brook University de Nueva York y es director del Phenomenology Research Center en esa misma universidad. Entre sus publicaciones cabe destacar Phenomenology and Mysticism, The Verticality of Religious Experience, publicado en 2007, Moral Emotions, Reclaiming the Evidence of the Heart, publicado en 2014, Knowing by Heart, Loving as Participation and Critique, publicado en 2021. Quisiera además destacar la publicación de Mundo Familiar y Mundo Ajeno, traducido por Rocío Garcés y Andrés Alonso, y como les dije en la mañana, está accesible en la librería de la Universidad Diego Portales y se lanzará el libro el miércoles. Professor Steinbock, although you are able to follow everything we say in Spanish, I will say a few words in English to express you in the name of the Institute of Philosophy our gratefulness for your visit, for this wonderful activity that your work is provoking, and for the generous attention you are paying to the works presented insofar. So you have the word. Thank you.
Thank you for the kind introduction. I'm also honored to be here, especially for the anniversary of the founding of the university. And I'm grateful to the Universidad Diego Portales for inviting me. The work that Rocio and Andreas have done, both in translating the work Home and Beyond into Spanish, and also for organizing such a wonderful gathering. I'd also like to thank Professor Carlos Peña, the president of the university, and Aisha, Professor Aisha Messina, for her kind support of the project, the conference, and again for the introduction. Thank you very much. And the warm welcome I've received from everyone here, the generous hospitality for the people in the Institute, the students, and I look forward to the coming days. And thank you for listening to me in English. I don't presuppose that this is the way it should be. It's just that I would not want to inflict my spoken Spanish on you at this moment. I'll do that at another time. Yes, at another point when it's not so much harm. Okay. The work that's under discussion in these days concern Home and Beyond generative phenomenology after Husserl. And it might contain some unfamiliar concepts like phenomenology and generativity. So let me introduce briefly some of the main concepts before going into the more detailed reading and scope of the implications of generative phenomenology. Also, the Spanish translation of this is available, also thanks to Andres. Second, I want to describe the distinctiveness. Well, first, I'll describe the project of phenomenology and trace it to generative phenomenology and proposing that phenomenology is generative phenomenology. And second, I would like to describe the distinctiveness of a generative phenomenology within the context of Edmund Husserl, who is considered to be the founder of phenomenology. In a third part, I want to describe the double sense of generativity. And finally, I would like to raise the question concerning our descriptive access to generativity and the problem of evidence for phenomenology. There'll be three subjects just to get you a little familiar with where it's going: generativity and verticality, emotions and the heart, and generativity as loving. And so then I'll just conclude with a brief suggestion concerning possible themes for phenomenology. So first of all, phenomenology as generative phenomenology. Phenomenology is a special kind of reflection that does not want to take things for granted, but strives to examine the meaning of things as they're given an experience, as well as to describe their structures. What we call the natural attitude is the attitude that takes the world for granted in a commonplace way, such that we become forgetful of the very emergence of meaning for us. This forgetfulness, which becomes like second nature, constitutes its naivete and what makes it philosophically susceptible to critique. Radically shifting attitudes from straightforwardly accepting what something is to how that something is given, phenomenology clarifies this very what or being that was taken for granted. Inquiries into both aspects, namely the how and the what, make up the process of phenomenological investigation in a very general way. Questions concerning meaning constitution or modes of givenness and essential structures or being are those two ways of articulating the how and the what. For example, perceiving a world, we do not taste our tasting or see our seeing or immediately think our thinking. We do not immediately, if at all, notice that the whole of the object is given through sides, that sides are given through aspects, that aspects are given through adumbrations, like a before and an after, or a woolly red of a carpet, that adumbrations are given through phases, like the present or the past or the future. We don't see how sense orients us, towards being such that this being makes a difference, or how meaning is that aspect under which being speaks to us, is comprehensible and is grasped as such. We might take for granted a body-soul dualism without realizing the distinctive role that the lived body plays, or again, assume a spirit-nature dualism without accounting for how the earth gives meaning to the lived body and how we orient ourselves spatially and temporally. Important to recognize is that the phenomenological shift in perspective is carried out so as no longer to presuppose what being is, and instead to understand the meaning of being in which we already participate, and to participate in being creatively. Such a postural shift allows the attitude of taking things for granted to come into view as natural, as mundane, or naive. It is from such a phenomenological perspective that we can, in fact, identify our perceptual and intellectual relations with being as a participation in being as meaningful or as having sense or even nonsense. In short, phenomenology acknowledges the naive basis of reflection, but distances itself from this basis in order to gain it in a new way, critically. Phenomenological reflection steps back from this basis in order to bring it into relief in its fullness, to witness the initial strangeness of meaning in what has become for us so obvious, and thus to describe the process of meaning formation in its open unfamiliarity. This is a dynamic process that has long since been taken for granted with routine practicality. Further, the phenomenologist does not merely reflect on experience, but reflects within experiencing itself as it is being lived through. By reflecting on and within the sense-giving process itself, we grasp it in its living movement so that we can glimpse how and what the process means, intends, or accepts. If we take a quick glance ahead now to generative phenomenology, we can say that it is a philosophical method that is open to socio-historical, cultural, geological, and normative generation of meaning in our lives together. It treats the normative significance of territories and terrains, the earth as ground of bodily beings, the world as a horizon of objects that emerge for us. It shows how traditional notions of normality and abnormality take on richer, dynamic and subtle forms. It shows how norms arise within experience itself. It describes the intersubjective relations of home worlds and alien worlds as they develop dynamically and intertwine over the generations, and how the meaning of the home, or our worlds, are mutually dependent upon and co-originate with alien or other worlds. However, part of the meaning of generative phenomenology concerns the generation of generative phenomenology itself, and in order to grasp the implications as well as the future of generative phenomenology, and thus phenomenology itself, it's likewise important to provide a sketch of its unfolding. It entails, in part, recounting Edmund Husserl's own starting point and development in phenomenology. For those of you who are unfamiliar with Edmund Husserl, he was born in Prosnitz, Moravia, which is now in the Czech Republic, and he published only a handful of works, left 40,000, 45,000 stenographed pages, which are almost impossible to read for various reasons. So there are specialists who do this. It would amount to over 100,000 typescript pages. And the main thing here is that it inspired some of the most significant movements and thinkers in contemporary thought. Max Scheler, Martin Heidegger, Edith Stein, Hedwig Conrad Martius, Simone de Beauvoir, Jean-Paul Sartre, Maurice Merleau-Ponty, Jacques Derrida, Emmanuel Levinas, Hans-Georg Gadamer, so traditions of hermeneutics, Paul Ricoeur, and a host of others. And he died in Freiburg in 1938. He was born in 1859 and died in 1938. That's a brief biological overview. In terms of his philosophical method, Husserl noticed the richness, complexity, and the fecundity of our world of life, and perhaps for reasons of clarity, of purpose, and of mastery, he began describing this dynamic articulated unity of being one step at a time, statically, now, with its subtle, intentional, constitutive structures of consciousness in relationship to its object. He quite consciously wanted to begin with simple phenomena in order to detail their finer distinctions. And then move to more complex ones. He would go from one sense field progressing to the lived body as a whole, etc. And I'm not suggesting that this is the most efficacious manner of proceeding in all instances. There are many others who start in different registers, but it does have its appeal because even a single intentional moment discloses a world. And this is already difficult and complex. He thought, why would we then put ourselves at a disadvantage by beginning with much more complex phenomena whose basis we have not even clarified yet? So in this way, Husserl's style of description and implicit methodology would go from what he calls the simple to the complex, from the lower to the higher, and in some cases, from what is founding to what is founded. But things changed discursively for him when he reached those more complex and higher phenomena. At this point, he noticed that he was already describing phenomena that went beyond what he presupposed his method would allow. It was not a matter of discounting his conclusions, but it became a task for him of methodologically giving an account of these richer and more complex phenomena. It was at this time, so in terms of dates, at least by the 1920s, he formulated a distinction between static phenomena and genetic phenomena, and between different kinds of methods, what he called a static method and a genetic method. Genetic phenomena included matters like kinesthesis, or the bodily movement, normality and abnormality, self-temporalization, investigations into instinct and facticity, already in the, just to situate it for those of you who are familiar with Heidegger, this was 1916, 1917, 1920, so way before Being in Time, for example. Concordance and discordance, the problem of sleep as a constitutive problem, optimality, affectivity, passive genesis, motivation, many of these kinds of themes. All right. I mentioned that things tended to change for Husserl discursively at this point, and I mean by this not only that he explicitly formulated a distinction between methods, but that he recast his evaluation of genetic and static phenomena. So having reached these so-called higher or complex phenomena, he requalified them. So what was formerly termed lower or simple is these things that he started with are now considered abstract and founded. And what was higher or complex now is called most concrete, and even in some cases, founding. So he now describes the whole, the articulated unity of being, from the perspective of genetic insights, in which case the static ones, which were formerly simple and independent, are now dependent and abstract. So why is this important? In my reading of the then relatively recently published material, recently 30 years ago published, well, time flies, and especially the unpublished manuscripts, which were again unpublished at that time, I noticed a new problem field that was characterized by the terminology of this weird phrase called generative phenomena. And this occurred in places that were fundamentally new phenomena where they were being described, phenomena that were irreducible to genetic ones. These included, these new phenomena, new in the sense of what we thought was there, new ones like homeworld and alien world, home companions, birth and death as constitutive features of experience, appropriation and transgression as kinds of constitution, familiarity and non-familiarity as modes of normality and abnormality. And these were articulated around this other term, generativity. So I noticed that the emergence, that there was an emergence of a similar pattern between genetic and generative phenomena that occurred between static and genetic phenomena. So again, we have to remind ourselves that Husserl is always already working, at least implicitly, within the whole of the articulated unity of being. Or, as I'll put it differently now, working within the movement of generativity. Is already there at generativity, even if it does not become an explicit theme. So when he does arrive there, he can write that the most concrete phenomenon is generativity. When we abstract from the dimension of historicity, when we abstract the dimension of historicity from generativity, we arrive at self-temporalization, and when we abstract temporality from this genetic phenomena, we arrive at static intending consciousness. Of course, there was never any mention by Husserl of a generative phenomenology. In the specific sense, it did not exist as method. But it struck me that the next movement had to be taken for Husserl, but more significantly for phenomenology as a whole. All of this demanded a generative phenomenology of generativity as the most concrete but not exclusive dimension of phenomenology. Thus, in some sense, all phenomenology is or was already generative phenomenology, prompting Husserl to suggest that even the phenomenologists find them, that even the phenomenologists, which is on the one hand supposed to be presuppositionless, on the other hand, find themselves within generativity. Phenomenology is generative phenomenology, or alternately, generative phenomenology is phenomenology as such. Accordingly, I would say doing static phenomenology is already doing generative phenomenology from the position of the static, and describing static phenomena is already describing generativity from the angle of static constitution. It was with this understanding that I attempted to advance generative phenomenology. So, section two, the distinctiveness of generative phenomenology. To some, Husserl's arrival at generativity and our understanding of a generative phenomenology, including the range of experiences that it covers, may sound a lot like the influential 19th century philosopher of the dialectic, Hegel, and his phenomenology of spirit, which was, of course, influential for Marx and later French political thought. But despite some similarities, there are four main points of difference that are instructive, and they help to illuminate the distinctiveness of an Husserlian-inspired generative phenomenology. So first, whereas for Hegel the project of phenomenology ended with a phenomenologist who happened to be there at the right time and who happened to be Hegel, the project of a generative phenomenology is situated within generativity such that generative phenomenology cannot end with Husserl in the way a phenomenology of spirit ends with Hegel. That is, phenomenology becomes a communal effort, not just among contemporary phenomenologists, but as a project handed down, appropriated, and transformed over the generations. Phenomenology itself is modified according to the historicity of the times and in terms of the facticity of the individual phenomenologists. They take a stand on the constitution of intersubjective meaning, as well as the historical development of phenomenology, by being committed to a certain optimal and teleological development of philosophy. This does not mean that there are no essential structures, but that these structures emerge as historical a priori's. Second, whereas for Hegel, a phenomenology of spirit requires only one phenomenologist in the sense of any indeterminate phenomenological philosopher, for Husserl, the uniqueness of this phenomenologist is essential. The generative phenomenologist and phenomenology stand within a specific historicity or specific historicities. And this means that it matters who the phenomenologist is and becomes. As the historicity of the situation changes, the phenomenologist must critically describe and normatively participate in the generation of intersubjective and historical life. Moreover, the phenomenologist must continually account for the changes that she or he introduces into generativity as a functionary of humanity. Third, the Hegelian phenomenologist at most can describe only new factical events that express the same meaning structures that have already been historically accomplished and laid bare by the phenomenologist, namely Hegel. Or put differently, any subsequent phenomenologist would only have the task of repeating or imitatively working through what the first phenomenologist already observed, retrospectively reiterating and remembering them in order to begin philosophy. At most, he or she would describe the repetition of meaning shapes in the form of possibly new events or new occurrences, new historical occurrences. This is the case because all the meaning structures for Hegel have been exhausted or must have been exhausted in order to begin philosophy. This is why Hegel places the phenomenologist at the historical or the experiential completion of those shapes and at the standpoint of non-experiential knowing. And this is why for the Hegelian phenomenologist, it's impossible to experience, for the Hegelian phenomenologist, which who is now the philosopher, to experience crises, although experiencing consciousness does. But for the generative phenomenologist, the structure of generativity precludes such a closure, either conceived of as an overcoming of alienness or as an exhaustion of meaning structures. The generative phenomenologist, or more accurately, generative phenomenologists, in their uniqueness and within their historicities, experience crises according to future open and enticing possibilities, and are consequently involved in the critical project of renewing and generating, and not merely repeating, meaning structures. This again places the role in the vocation of the Husserlian phenomenologists as functionaries of humanity. Thus, generative phenomenology is always already critical in its descriptive enterprise. And I do put that line in there that it's already critical in relationship to a different attempt at talking about a critical phenomenology as if phenomenology were not always already and necessarily critical. Finally, while there is something clearly identifiable as Hegelian phenomenology, by the time one reaches a generative phenomenology, the attribution of phenomenology to Husserl becomes more ambiguous. Factually, generative phenomenology was never contained within Husserl's writings. But more importantly, in order for generative phenomenology to be generative phenomenology, it must go beyond being merely Husserl's phenomenology. I don't mean this in the sense that Husserlian phenomenology is defective in sometimes in ways that Schütz or Habermas or Adorno or even Ricoeur at times use the term, although Ricoeur did say every good phenomenologist is a Husserl heretic. Rather, it belongs to the very structure of generative phenomenology that it goes beyond itself. And perhaps this sheds light on the oft-cited phrase that the phenomenologist is a perpetual beginner. Generative phenomenology is both after Husserl, in the sense that Husserl did not use this term, did not formulate a generative phenomenology, and came historically after him. But it is also after him in the sense that generative phenomenology traces out the movement, motivations, and leading clues according to what Husserl disclosed, which means that it is also a creative or a generative effort. In this sense, generative phenomenology does not belong to Husserl, but he belongs to it, and in a similar way, we as phenomenologists belonging to generativity belong to the effort of a generative phenomenology. Section 3, the double sense of generative phenomenology and generativity. So what does generative phenomenology describe? I mentioned in my epilogue to the superb Spanish translation that we have, thanks to both the professors sitting here, that I used generativity and generative phenomenology in two ways, at times more explicitly and more implicitly than others. On the one hand, I understood it as a specific dimension of phenomenological investigation, as distinct from static and genetic methods. Accordingly, a generative phenomenology covered certain generative phenomena that did not, and in some cases could not, appear within a static method or a genetic method. And the examples of these would be ritual, generation gaps, birth and death as world constitutive features, cultural traditions, rites of passage, narrative phenomena, the appropriation of meaning, historicity, etc. In this way, generative phenomenology would be attuned to geohistorical, normative, and intersubjective phenomena, especially the relation of homeworld and alien world. But as you might suspect from what I've presented here, generativity and generative phenomenology took on larger meanings. I also understood generativity to mean the very movement itself from which emerges the relation home-alien. It, namely generativity, is not anything, but instead the dynamic movement, infinite becoming or origination, that Husserl understood implicitly as the kind of new absolute, but not where this absolute is anything, but rather movement. So while a generative phenomenology in the lower case covers all generative phenomena, generative phenomenology, uppercase, deals with generativity as such, and thus all thematic dimensions covered by static, genetic, and generative methods. Accordingly, generative phenomenology stands within the generative movement, generativity, as it attempts to grasp the meaning of this movement in its unfolding. That is why it is perhaps more helpful to speak now of a generative method alongside static and genetic methods, and a generative phenomenology, which is identifiable as phenomenology itself and as the phenomenology of and within generativity. Thus, in a restrictive sense, generativity refers to the relation of homeworld and alien world, to the historicity of sense that's appropriated and disappropriated over the generations, etc. But in a deeper sense, generative phenomenology describes the very movement of generativity itself, which gives home and alien, and indeed all phenomena. I suggested just a bit ago that since generativity is the very movement from which emerges the historical, intersubjective, normative structures, the normative structures home alien, that any philosophical reflection, even a phenomenological one that gives account of generativity and generative phenomena, does so within generativity. But an important clarification should be made, one that will help to elucidate the parameters of this claim. Generativity is both an essential structure, and yet its revelation is peculiar to a certain cultural and historical tradition, and most broadly an Abrahamic Greek tradition. Generativity, an historical essence as it were, was indeed revealed in this broad tradition and is this very process by which there are normatively significant structures that have a unique and irreducible orientation. In and through their difference, generativity makes an historical difference. Generativity becomes articulated normatively, socially, geohistorically in the very structure home alien. When we speak of the generative nexus home-alien, we're describing the movement of generativity and hence the entire framework. The whole of generativity, that movement, however, is not described from an objective third-person perspective, but from within the home and not just a home, in this case, within generativity. I do not mean here that there is a home world within a generative framework, but generativity is itself home in a broader sense, and accordingly the structure of generativity, as I've expressed, does not merely account for the differences that would be alien to a particular home, but for the possibility of something radically alien even to generativity itself. So, put in different terms, I'm not saying generativity is universal, but it is an a priori structure, and the structure home alien is encompassed, it's not just is encompassed by generativity, but it's such that generativity itself is home in relationship to which something else could emerge that doesn't fit that structure. For example, emptiness in Zen Buddhism. But it would still be able to account for itself, for something other than itself, in understanding all relation as home alien. And it would also be able to account for certain emotions that we would not find and structurally could not find in other traditions. Okay, so it's not, my point is not a claim to something like universality. Okay, the fourth point, access to generativity and the problem of evidence. If generative phenomenology is a phenomenology of generativity, which is infinite origination, then we have to ask, phenomenologically, what is our access to generativity as such? That is a generativity in which we already find ourselves. Husserl, in his own way, broached the question of access, though it did not pertain explicitly to generativity at all. Certainly, generativity gives itself in and through the home-alien relation, and home is given to itself through transgressive encounters with alienness. This relation is co-foundational with respect to both home and alienness. When Husserl inquires into matters of alienness, he does not simply address its being, which would remain within the natural attitude, but confronts our modes of access to it. Alien, he writes, alienness is accessible in the mode of inaccessibility and incomprehensibility. In short, alienness is given in the mode of not being able to be given. It is given as not being able to be grasped or known in an originary way. It's experienced precisely as not being able to be experienced. In this regard, alienness is constituted liminally as what we could call a limit phenomenon. But we have to ask, what presuppositions are in play in order for us to describe something given as not being able to be given? The presupposition is that there is one and only one mode of givenness that counts for experience and evidence. For a majority of Western philosophy since the Enlightenment, and for the most part, even Husserl, this applies to Husserl, this is the presentation of an object which ultimately has a rational structure, no matter how broadly one conceives reason or rationality here. If something not only is not given, but by its very nature cannot be given as an object, like a person, it is said not to appear, not to be experienceable, not to be genuinely accessible. Phenomenologically, this is to say that it is given, so we're accounting for modes of givenness, precisely as not being able to be given. It's constituted liminally, even if what is constituted liminally might change depending upon our methodological openness, even within the sphere of presentation. And presentation, I mean perceptual acts or perceptual functions, judicative acts, things like that. Yet what if this view is short-sighted? If phenomenology is, as it should be, open to all kinds of givenness as they give themselves and in the distinctive way in which they give themselves, if phenomenology is open to this, no matter how they give themselves and whether or not they conform to our prejudices or expectations, what does this say about givenness, evidence, and phenomenology? It opens the question of what is accessible to phenomenological description beyond presentational givenness, that is, beyond that which is presented in perceptual functions and judicative acts. This invites three strains of thought concerning, first of all, the kinds of givenness that transcend presentational givenness, what I call verticality. Secondly, the relation between vertical givenness and presentational givenness. And thirdly, the deepening of givenness and generativity in terms of what it reveals. So, first of all, generativity and verticality. The phenomenologist becomes attentive to all modes of givenness, even if they do not necessarily conform to a presentational style of givenness. Those modes of givenness that do not conform to objects of a perception or a judgment, I've termed vertical givenness, or as a whole, verticality. Modes of givenness are vertical in the sense that they take us beyond themselves, beyond ourselves, and are evocative rather than necessarily responding to or corresponding to our efforts to provoke them into appearance. Just because something does not appear like an object in a perception or a judgment does not mean that there is no givenness, no experience, or no possibility of evidence, or no possibility of deception. We arrive at vertical modes of givenness by evaluating what is actually given in human experience, and it is this sensitivity that requires us to expand what counts as evidence. This expansion, which is grounded in experience, opens us to the religious, the moral, the ecological spheres of existence, even though the quality of these kinds of experiences is fundamentally different from the ways in which we might experience objects appearing in perception or judgments. Because the religious, the moral, and the ecological dimensions are given, though in their own ways, they're susceptible to critical philosophical thinking. Accordingly, generativity is not merely a limit phenomenon, but a givenness of a radical kind such that it does not correspond to a noesis noema style of experience, that is to say, a subject-object relation, let's say, and is not reducible to presentation. Generativity, in this respect, is verticality. Verticality elicits those dynamic vectors of experience and have a unique structure all their own. The height and depth of what is experienced, the process of participating being expressed in terms of value and value feeling. From the perspective of mere epistemic presentation, it might be called mystery, the uncontrollable, or the wild dimension of experience that is not a mere nothing. For example, just because I cannot ultimately control or grasp other persons does not mean that they are an absence, or that they're a rupture in my freedom, or they're other than the given, even if they are ultimately removed from my control. They are given, but in a full but inexhaustible presence, yet not in a way that an object unfolds according to my perceptual solicitation. Home and Beyond was the beginning of an inquiry into evidence rather than an end, and became a platform for future work in more expansive dimensions of evidence. As I mentioned, my first way of developing the internal movement of generativity beyond its admittedly sketchy and suggestive beginning was with the notion of verticality. These modes of vertical givenness bear on a variety of dimensions of human experience, a religious dimension of experience, a moral dimension of experience, the experience of objects as icons, exposure, which is an aesthetic, lived bodily dimension of experience, a dimension of experience where the earth as ground is concerned, and the experience of elemental beings of the earth. They all have their distinctive manners of givenness, and they delimit, that is, they point to and open up other modes of givenness in their own ways, to the ecological, to the holy, to the moral, and so on. So in a subsequent work, Phenomenology and Mysticism, I described how the verification of religious experience is eternal to its own kind of experiencing and occurs on this level of experiencing. Since the peculiar style of givenness concerning the sphere of the holy, for example, does not conform to a rational style of evidence, the former's unique way of givenness, as well as its difficulties, its deceptions, its illusions, its confirmations, etc., have to be understood in a particular phenomenological style and not excluded from philosophical consideration. But perceptual evidence cannot authenticate, for example, the experience of another person, or cannot authenticate spiritual experiencing, just as a perceptual experience cannot be ratified by some kind of spiritual experiencing. They're different in kind, and it's not governed by or adjudicated by a rational reflection on those kinds of experiencing. Not adjudicated by it, even though there, if there is rational reflection on it. The different modes of givenness and different absolutes to which I referred above, and the descriptions of them in current work, were only intimated in Home and Beyond, in part because this work was restricted to Husserl. But ultimately, phenomenology, or generative phenomenology, has to account for all that is given in its own way, and this requires clarifying generativity. The religious sphere of experience, the moral, bodily, ecological dimensions of experience. These correspond to certain absolutes as we live them and as they're intertwined. But again, these were only alluded to in Home and Beyond rather than developed. Excuse me for a second. Okay, the second subsection, emotional cognition, the heart, and presentation. I remarked that this investigation opened to three strains of thought concerning phenomenological description. The second set of questions concerns the relation between vertical givenness and presentational givenness. For example, do acts of vertical dimensions, what I call vertical dimensions, the religious, the moral, or the ethical, do they have their own structures, or are they dependent on more basic structures of experience? More specifically, are emotional acts founded in presentational ones? Does feeling or valuing, in order to be what it is, that have to be founded in perception in order to have their own relational structure? This is something, for example, that Husserl contends. Is it the case that valuing acts are non-cognitive, non-objectifying, and they're founded in presentational objectifying acts? It is not a matter of here of denying that our epistemic relation with objects is a legitimate form of experience. Rather, it's a matter of questioning the privilege of rational epistemic meaning asserted in modernity over the emotional sphere of cognition. Even more, it's a matter of recognizing that epistemic openness is not just different from, but rooted in, emotional cognitive openness. The task, therefore, is not to continue to ignore what modernity has ignored, namely the role of the emotions, especially what I call interpersonal emotions, and the possibilities that are opened by them. This was one of the things that I wanted to show in Moral Emotions, which Ignacio Quepons has translated into Spanish, as well, almost simultaneously appearing with the translation of Home and Beyond. Through the interpersonal or moral emotions, it's possible to retrieve what was excluded in modernity without trying to go back abstractly to an earlier pre-critical social imaginary, and yet to go forward beyond our current modern predicament and postmodern impasse by appropriating these resources. Experiences like loving, humility, trust, repentance, even shame, guilt, and pride reveal the person as interpersonal. And we discover in our self-revelations that we're inherently relational, given to ourselves most deeply, to use an expression that I now, I did prefer the beloved, rather than like the myself. The point is that it's given as not self-grounding. Actually, in the new term that I'll introduce later is called the proper name. But in order to express this differently, it's not only a matter of seeing the ways in which the emotions offer distinctive modes of existence and coexistence. It is a matter of understanding how the emotions have already been functional where persons are concerned, but have been excluded in favor of other modern preferences. Beginning with the beloved as constituted through loving poses a key challenge for phenomenology. From where do we get the meaning of givenness as loving such that loving would be accessible phenomenologically on this level of experience? How can this take place such that this core phenomenon of the human person could be qualified more concretely as beloved. Is it still phenomenology that we have in mind? And if so, what kind of phenomenology is it? What emphases in phenomenology are under consideration? A phenomenological account of loving leads one beyond what a phenomenological account usually handles, at least according to many interpretations. While such an account might begin with an act phenomenology, where loving is considered as one human act among others, like among trust or shame or repentance, something like that, we find ourselves immediately taken beyond this human act execution in important ways, ways that enter into all-encompassing issues. Now, I don't mean by this that we're already thrown into speculative issues, but we're drawn into matters that bear on all reality, what we think of with the expression ultimate reality or the mystery of emergent being. We are therefore drawn into issues that one is tempted to call metaphysical. My point is that especially where loving is concerned, an act phenomenology is to be grounded in the metaphysical reality to which phenomenology is open, and as a reality that is also accessible phenomenologically. Recognizing this movement as generativity or verticality or loving, the human person is revealed as beloved. Radical self-presencing, radical self-givenness as beloved. And when I say self-givenness, I don't mean myself self-giving, but as being given to oneself. Okay, the third section, generativity as loving. Epiphany and revelation are two modes of vertical givenness. Through epiphany, well, this is a term, it's just another term I wanted to use instead of presentation. In any case, we're revealed to ourselves most fundamentally as beloved. Any other revealing act, in the specific sense of shame or guilt or sympathy, and so on, points back in its own way or clarifies and disposes us to this fundamental revelation of loving or being given as beloved. This beloved is relational, or rather interpersonal, from the very start. I'm given to myself as not self-grounding. I receive myself as beloved, as relational, no matter how implicitly. Of course, I can reify the relation, I can dissimulate the interconnected dynamic such that I take myself as self-grounding, merely as I. This would be the problem, the mystery of the origin of an emotion that we call pride. Schematically speaking, it's possible to say that all creation is beloved, such that first and foremost, we're not creatures or creation, but beloveds. For something to be given as beloved, it's already moving within that openness of loving, such that the evidence of the beloved is only given within that movement and in that participation. Thus, beloved is another term for what's primordially given through this kind of givenness that I'm calling loving, whether that given or that beloved be inanimate, organic, or personal. There are many ways in which this loving is present as beloved, from strings, quarks, particles, elements, dust clouds, vast nebula, inorganic matter, energy, atmosphere, the simple forms of single cell life, psychophysical beings, and person. Those beloveds who love are constituted as persons. Persons are not in principle restricted to human beings. Rather, personhood can in principle be revealed through any species, precisely as beloveds who love. To express it another way, all that is, all reality, is expressive of this movement that I'm calling loving. Now, I don't say this here, but there's an important distinction between this movement loving as what I'm going to call participating being and a feeling state, the feeling state of being in love or the feeling state of sadness or any kind of feeling state. There's a fundamental, essential distinction between those. So when I'm speaking of loving, I mean it as this movement. There are other acts as well, but but we don't want to confuse like being in love or being happy with something like loving, or even hating with hatred. Hatred as a feeling state, hating as this movement. Okay. So I make an important distinction between a participating in being that is peculiar to presentational givenness, perception and judgment, for example, and loving as participating being, peculiar to vertical loving. In presentation, the mode of givenness found in functions or perceptions, functions of perceptions and acts of judgment, I relate to being by participating in being. This takes place passively, pre-positing, or by actively positing being. As Husserl puts it, my belief posture accepts being straightforwardly such that it asserts that it is and what it is. Of course, I can question being, I can doubt it, live an event as possible or impossible, but in each case, there's still a presupposition of being throughout all of its modalities and modalizations. My relation with being and presentation still adheres to this basic dynamic of correlation. Loving and distinction is related to being as participating being. I mean by this that the movement of loving is a receiving being as it is, such that the latter is able to become as it is toward its flourishing. I use the expression participating being without any preposition like participating in, participating with, and so on, in order to evoke the immediate, direct partaking or presencing peculiar to loving. Loving participates being such that what is given is already revealed as beloved, giving more than itself and realizing itself in the specific way of being given. Adapting a characterization of charity by Teilhard de Chardin, the vertical movement of loving carries things forward as they are while inviting them to appear beyond themselves instead of simply leaving them behind. Loving is a movement toward the flourishing or enhancement of the beloved in its own most way, that is, within what I call its own magnitude or its value range. Within that specific magnitude, the beloved can become ever richer in its own sphere of value. Instead of diminishing, loving lets all beings become who or what they are according to how they are and enlarges its scope to become in an upward lifting force intrinsic to every form of human endeavor. It is the expansion of richness and diversity toward unity in a single operation. Only in this sense is loving to be understood as an acquiescence to a loving situation, what the mystics often call surrender. It is the verticality in things that demands that we go to the heart of the matter, and it's why environmental issues cannot be dealt with merely environmentally. It's also why even a being that experiences the barest effect of pains and pleasures, or one that feels sadness or contentment, already participates in infinite personal loving precisely by experiencing bodily pains and pleasures, sadness or contentment. Since an appropriate summary of this section also requires a review of this presentation as a whole, I'll move directly to my concluding remarks. I began this talk with the emergence of generative phenomenology in relation to generative phenomena, and I broached the issue of generativity and the problem of evidence in the phenomenology of Edmund Husserl, and I opened the final section of this presentation by questioning the seemingly arbitrary limitation of givenness to how something is presented as an object of perception or judgment. And I suggested that generativity is not merely a liminal concept for phenomenology, but is experienced in fundamentally distinctive ways, and therefore open to unique phenomenological description. It may seem odd that this has led to other matters like vertical givenness, verticality, the beloved, loving, emotions, value, and the like. This is one way in which the internal dynamic of generativity can be worked out, but of course not an exclusive way. One can give a different account, an account that suggests being, knowing beings, and beings and the relation of being are foundational for loving and the beloveds. However, these accounts have radically different metaphysical and ontological implications that I've outlined elsewhere. For example, at least for me, the issue does not revolve around kinds of thinking, kinds of forgetfulness, withdrawal, absence, being there, but kinds of loving and hating, overflowing presencing, beloved person, verticality. Is it phenomenological? I think so. Is it Husserlian? That depends. In a certain sense, it is not, in the same way that one would say that generative phenomenology is not by Husserl. But in a certain sense, it's Husserlian. It is not Husserlian in the sense that Husserl seems to remain committed to the idea that emotional acts and valuing, for example, are dependent upon a presentational core in order to remain relational acts. On the other hand, is it any coincidence that Husserl was led, perhaps despite his theoretical convictions, to describe precisely these kinds of phenomena? And these are coming out in later works, as most of you know. He's describing vocations, absolute ought, loving, justice, faith, value, God. So what is generativity? Today, I would call it loving as participating being. And since we are already participated as beloved, generative phenomenology is one way of participating this loving responsibly, discerningly, and creatively. It concerns how we are given or revealed to ourselves, how we generate or participate that revealed being, that participation. How we are revealed to ourselves and how we generate or participate being, including ourselves, points to a distinctive task for phenomenology. It also points to a phenomenology of vocational experience, which will be the topic, actually, of my next presentation tomorrow. Well, thank you very much for your attention. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias. Thank you very much. Bueno, es tiempo ahora de hacer preguntas. Wolfert, sí, el micrófono lo tiene.
Thank you very much for your talk. My question is about the metaphor of verticality that you use.
Yes.
Because I'm wondering what is at stake in using that metaphor rather than another metaphor. It seems that verticality suggests one dimensionality and it also suggests hierarchy,
yes.
Superior and inferior, above and below.
Yes.
And yes. So thinking about this, it occurred to me there is another metaphor that one might use for what you're referring to, if I understand correctly what you're referring to, which is a metaphor that I think Heidegger uses in Being and Time, which is the metaphor of the web of significations, the way in which things that are presently given refer in various ways to things that are not presently given, in this kind of web-like way, which is multidimensional, which is not hierarchical. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering whether there's any, what is at stake in you using that metaphor of verticality rather than maybe metaphor of the web or some other metaphor?
Thank you. I'll try to be brief because it's partly historically based for me. There's an experiential basis and then I think even a political one. Experientially, I'll just point out, I was climbing. I just learned how to climb. Actually, when I was in Germany and then in France and in Luxembourg, and I was terrified. I went with a friend, and I thought, why would anybody want to do this? I wound up loving it, but at first, you know, I was just clinging to the rock face and trying to overpower it, really.
And when I finally made it to the top, you know, like 45 minutes later, my arms were so tired that I couldn't even lift up a bottle of water. And we were out there for over a week, and little by little, I started to learn how to read the rock face, look at other chalk marks, and then I also wasn't clinging to it. And when we got back to, so, and then I could do this in like 15 minutes. And so what I noticed was that perceptually things changed, that I wasn't trying to dominate it, but that I was being led up and by the path, by the interaction of the rock face, and it didn't have this same meaning. And then when we got back to the city, I noticed how, I mean, after a week or so out there, I kept on just always looking up, but as being guided by. And I noticed how our perceptions are flattened. Even if we try to get very high, it's to surveil, to observe things or to, you know, in a sense, conquer them. And not the sense of letting go in it. So that's when I was first thinking about this upward sense of verticality. Okay, that's just a quick experiential moment. But also politically, this probably took too long to work out, so I won't deal with it. But I noticed that certain political organizations would try to flatten out those relations, certain relations. And this has to do with the movement of modernity and different attempts at overcoming certain divisions societally in different discourses of a bourgeois ideology or what Lefort would call a totalitarian ideology and so on. And so what's at stake is precisely that there are kinds of hierarchy that are not dominating. There are kinds of powers that are not control over another. And they're like respect or recognizing the integrity of another person over myself. And these don't have to be dominating ones. So I was using the term because I wanted it to be provocative. Precisely, it's too, the web for me is too neutral, and it doesn't really suggest these many different relations, not just with the sense of the religious, but another person, even ecological ones, aesthetic ones, that, you know, pull me up. And then there's maybe one other reason why that when I started stumbling on this notion, I noticed all these other thinkers of different kinds. Bachelard, Merleau-Ponty, Erwin Strauss, poets, all use this term verticality. It just was coming up everywhere. And I thought that this was really a dimension that was underplayed and ignored precisely because it was an, evocative of what Merleau-Ponty would call the wild. I mean, he goes from the term depth to verticality. Interestingly, so I think that's what's at stake, and why I would do that. Now, right now, I use that term, but it's being supplanted by more like loving or something. That's even more, you know, strange in some ways because, you know, but I think it's also a concrete relation that we've also dismissed in terms of sentimentality. So it's the same reason that I would want to. That insist on something like loving to get out of its romantic the romantic connotations of it, or like identifying it with a feeling state, like being in love. It has to do with this radical movement of opening. I mean, all of these things can mean the same thing, and they have in different people and different philosophies. But that's what's at stake. If that's, I don't know if you're satisfactory, but.
It's working. I don't know whether you can see me from. Yeah, it's
okay. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you very much. It was extremely clear. It was very inspiring, thought-provoking. And the question I would like to address has to do with, let's say, with geography, right? Generative phenomenology rehabilitates an interest in geography. But let's try to think about something like intellectual geography. Right, in you've mentioned this phrase by Ricoeur, according to which those that continuated the heritage of the Husserlian phenomenology continued it in always in a heretical sense, right? But these heresies can be, in a certain sense, organized, right? Everyone is a heretical in his own way, but then you have families that are being constituted, right? And actually, the Italian philosopher Carla Canulo, in her book on the overturn of phenomenology, La fenomenologia rovesciata, speaks about phenomenological families, right? And she identifies at least two important phenomenological families within the French tradition of phenomenology, which is, let's say, the most developed tradition in the second part of the 20th century. So on the one hand, you would have the phenomenological family that stems from Merleau-Ponty, belonging to which it's Dufresne, Richir, Barbaras, and on the other hand, you will have the phenomenological family of Michel Henry, Jean-Luc Chrétien, Jean-Luc Marion, right. And now, so the simple question will be, where does generative phenomenology belong to, right? Because on the one hand, one has the impression that you are pursuing a philosophical gesture that one can find in Merleau-Ponty, right? This is what I try to evoke in my paper, and it was very clear in your talk, in the first parts of your talk, and also in the answer you gave to Wolfhard's question. But on the other hand, through the kind of descriptions you give, for instance, now of a givenness of a radical kind, a givenness of a different style, I think that you also place yourself in the vicinity of analysis such as those performed by Marion, for instance, right? Givenness in a radical kind is something that, in a Marionian perspective, can also be formulated, right? So the question will be, let's say, geographical, and I think we might also gain something if you could give us some hints about it. Now, I think more than this geographical question, there is something deeper. There is a deeper dividing line between these two families. And if we take the example of Merleau-Ponty and Marion as paragons of these two families, we see that they have a completely different usage of the paradox in the description, right? Marion embraces the paradox, right? There is no problem with the paradox. Yes, the phenomenology is paradoxical, so what, right? You have to embrace it, right? And of course, I mean, even if we did not knew anything about his social and political engagements, we could very well see his the background, right? On the other hand, what Merleau-Ponty tries to do is rather to not to formulate the paradox as such, but to say, well, if there is a paradox, it is because our concepts are not fine-grained enough. So we have to devise more specific, more precise, more minute concept, right? More. And so then the question would be at the more conceptual and profound level, where do you stand in this debate? Independently, actually, whether this description corresponds or not to the authors I've mentioned, but I think it is a general problem in when one attempts to describe phenomena that don't normally appear as such. I was a bit too long. Thank you.
No. Thank you. Those are both related questions. I would see there are two different tendencies. So the Melopontian trajectory, I think in many ways is, if I can put it like this, more Husserlian. And certainly there's that movement. And what I mean by that, that he's attempting to take up that project of articulating the pre-personal, the perceptual, as the so-called founding movement, you know, and he has a really nice description of the relation of what he means by founding and founded, and he sees it, you know, interconnected and so on. So he, you know, is generous with Husserl in that sense. But moving to, from the so-called visibility to invisibility, or as he says, you know, we talked about this yesterday, in the origin of truth, or it's basically that movement of perception as founding of truth, and then he wanted to work out those other dimensions of experience founded in the perceptual that we could see. He did some partly, of course, in the political, in artistic realms, but then wanted to talk about the so-called flesh of history, whatever that would mean. So anyway, it's that movement that we see in Husserl in these descriptions from the lower to the higher kind of structure, even though let me just stop with that. But so, okay, that still, oddly enough, has some of the same prejudices as Husserl. And I wouldn't just say this, you know, because I'm assuming everybody also understands, or most people understand, the dynamic character of Melopontí, and so it can be qualified and so on. I would not place the other position, in relation to Marion. For example, I understand the different perspective in relation to Shaler. And I think Shaler is that other opening. That, as a matter of fact, others like Edith Stein, for example, also Jean Erin, you know, and there's a host of other Stavenhagen, perhaps, but mainly that other movement of Shaler, who described from the very beginning these different styles of givenness, even though he recognized the validity of one, but he was able to start at this so-called higher levels that weren't higher for him because he dealt with the structure of the motion. So the cognition of the heart. And that's, I think, if we wanted to talk about two different camps or two different geologies or two different families, I would say, well, I don't know. I mean, we're not trying to do it. But I'm sure it's more complex than two. But one would be distinctively in that kind of more Shaler orientation and insights. There is the Melopontian Husserlian, if I can be kind of crude about it. And then there, of course, are others that kind of mix in between, you know, like somewhat Levinas on the one side, somewhat Henri on the other. Interestingly, they describe similar phenomena from radically different things, so it's refreshing, really. Marion, Chrétien, and others who, not just because it's within the French school, but also are working from different starting points. So, yeah, I kind of have both those myself, foundations, or, you know, ancestries.
Anthony, thank you very much for your talk. I agree with you when you say that we should treat the term givenness in a very broad sense. So you mentioned the case of the earth or the other, which is given as inaccessible, the earth, which is given as an absolute ground, or even the world, which is given as a horizon. But there are still phenomena which can be given to the first person perspective. But when we move to more extreme cases like birth or primal instincts or the world of the newborn, don't you think that in those extreme cases we can lose the reference to the first person perspective? And so what would be the, what kind of phenomenology are we doing when we do phenomenology of primal instincts or sleep, birth? I'm sure they have asked you this many times, but I would love to know what you think. Thank you.
Sure. So there's a couple of questions there. I don't know if we lose the first person perspective, but I think the main, because phenomenology can also be accomplished in a second person perspective. And that would be the phenomenon of exemplarity, for example. There's that, that's one thing. So we can see in others the meaning of certain acts. Merleau-Ponty, for example, described the, just use Merleau-Ponty again, the phenomenon of the phantom limb without himself having a phantom limb. By virtue of other first-person accounts. Now, this is a hermeneutical issue, but that's not, I'm not saying that phenomenology is ever non-hermeneutical. So it's really a matter of not taking a third-person objective sense as if as our perspective, as if that counts as truth. So there's nothing against a second-person perspective. Also, I think that when, I'll just answer it using Husserl in that sense, the phenomenon of birth and death are excluded within a phenomenal, a genetic phenomenology, that kind of approach, because I, as constituting time, cannot constitute myself before myself, and or after myself, for example. But through the birth of a child, I'm constituted as parent, which is something I could not do. So I cannot, so in terms of first person constitution, just that I don't constitute myself as father, as mother, as parent, first person, even though I experience it first personally. But that's in relationship to the, this other. Also, birth and death are encompassed within a particular, if you want to say we world or home world or that other kind of generative structure, just as an example. So I think in that case, the home world is still a first person, but a first person plural. In the other example, in some of these other experiences in which I'm thrown back on myself or given to myself, it's always already interpersonal. Shame, for example, or pride or guilt, these are all they presuppose an interpersonal structure. So there's no way of simply being first person, even if it's my experience. So I think it broadens out or it gets in certain emotions. I don't know if I have an answer about the other answer about the other question, but sorry. The instincts. We would go into those are already the problem is that they are for us already articulated, and so we don't have access to that to a pure instinctual dimension. That's part of the if you want to call it a hermeneutic issue. But so when Husserl, to go back to Husserl. His attempt to describe the so-called passive levels presuppose the activity in which we realize there are presuppositions of that, which is why he then resorts to all those prefixes of pre to talk about these levels of experience that we can discern as distinctions, phenomenological distinctions, not separations, and articulate how the genesis of sense is founded in them from the perspective of activity. But otherwise, they remain, mute. Does Does that, did I answer your question, Emilio? Or questions? Not exactly? Okay.
Thank you. I have a question regarding your concept of love.
Yeah.
And so I understand that you distinguish love from being in love, so love as an intentional act and love as a feeling state. And so love is an emotion, but it's also a movement. And you mentioned in your book, in your last book, in Knowing by Heart and also in Moral Emotions, that, and you mentioned now that loving is a movement towards the flourishing of the other and enhancement of the other, but what the flourishing of the other is something that the other knows and can experience. So the this would be an, like, what experience do we have of the other vocation? Because the other person also has a vocation, and I cannot so prescribe what is good for the other person. So, I mean, so we can develop a phenomenology of vocation from the first person perspective, but then we have the problem of how to...
That's exactly right. So, it's not, so two things. First of all, so thank you. This is actually why a phenomenology, for me anyway, a phenomenology of vocation presupposes a phenomenology of loving and hating. Because there are two, maybe I want to say three things. There are two kinds of what this kind of givenness, what I'm calling revelation, but doesn't matter. It's just the non-presentational that concerns persons. There's the kind of way in which I'm given, I'm revealed to myself, or I'm given to myself, and the way in which another is revealed to me. And also I'm revealed to another, but so there's the issue of that. So first of all, it's not clear that I'm, that my knowing, literally my knowing by heart is any clearer for myself than it might be for another. For example, a parent, a teacher, a partner can have insight into who I am. And now this is all open, and I'm not saying who I am statically, eternally predestined, but have that sense. In a way, maybe that I don't. And this would presuppose that kind of loving, opening, insight into another. And you're right, it can't be appointed. You can't appoint, I can appoint a profession, a career, I can appoint a job, but I can't appoint a vocation. I have an example. Claude Lefort told me that, he was, of course, at the lycée when Merleau-Ponty was teaching, and to make a long story short, he wrote this paper, and Merleau-Ponty called him in and said, who, he wrote this really nice, this really good paper, okay. He says, who are you going to be? What, who are you? And Lefort is like, I don't know. I like, literature like this. And Merleau-Ponty said, you are a philosopher. And so Lefort said, I'm a philosopher, become a little philosopher and so on. It wasn't because Merleau-Ponty was appointing it, and Lefort did not take it in the sense of like, he's telling me what to do, but Merleau-Ponty, who cared about it, became his primary pupil in the discussions with Simone de Beauvoir and Sartre, in the temps moderne and all of that. Merleau-Ponty saw in him, at least, I don't want to use the term potential, but the insight of him being, that kind of openness of philosophy. Not that he had to be, but it was that kind of caring insight in which Merleau-Ponty saw better into him at that moment than he did himself, which then has to become confirmed and transformed and made historical and personal, or rejected, as that kind of insight. So I think that kind of openness is that, without being able to delimit in advance, that's the case, or certainly predetermined or a point. But that's an interpersonal dimension too, and that all I want to do is say sometimes another person can have that bearing, but that presupposes loving, just as hating is the negation of what one can become through structural hating, institutional hating, or, you know, event hating, you know, the particular holding down of another.
Yes, thank you. I was thinking about Husserl's idea of a community of love, for example.
Yeah.
Where so people live their life vocationally, and then the problem of harmony arises.
Exactly.
How do we live all together according to our own vocations?
Right, right. And so in the new work, I'm articulating that I may mention tomorrow, I forget, but something like vocational justice. It requires a vocational justice because we're also responsible for the becoming of others as we are for ourselves in that particular way. But that's the problem of, both Husserl and Shaler use the term Liebesgemeinschaft, a community of love or loving community, in distinction to, you know, Lebensgemeinschaft.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
¿Acaso, Diego, hay preguntas en el chat?
Sí, hay una pregunta en realidad. Pero bueno, está un poco compleja la redacción de la pregunta, por lo que pudimos dar cuenta es que en realidad quiere preguntar la persona si es que se puede, tomando en cuenta las comunidades de amor, si es que se puede errar a la hora de realizar fenomenología generativa o algo así, intentó preguntar.
¿Errar en qué sentido?
No lo explica. Si es que puede cometer un error, algo así, como, pero no podíamos entender de mejor manera a qué se refería.
I didn't catch it all acoustically.
Yeah, we didn't either. So I will try to translate it in English.
Okay.
Wolfhard, ¿me ayudarías a traducir la pregunta en inglés?
So the problem is that the question is not formulated in the clearest way, so we were trying to make sense of it.
Oh, yeah.
It has to do with error, with the possibility of error.
Of error.
Error, yes, in this generative phenomenology,
sure.
But we're not quite, there's
yes.
not much
yes.
more I can give you because
but
we're not sure what kind of error the person is
yes.
referring to.
Yeah,
of
so, error and we certainly have, and we've mapped out very, very well within a perceptual realm, let's say, the problem of disappointment or Enttäuschung, and how the sense of the object is retroactively crossed out in the retention on the basis of a new present, and so on, perceptually. And what we haven't done, so basically modalizations on the perceptual realm, and phenomenologically speaking, in at least within Husserl, and what we haven't done is articulated what those modalizations, deceptions, things like that, what they look like in the interpersonal dimension, for example. Well, first of all, I want to say it's not just a matter, when I say evidence, I mean like the domain of evidence. That means something is given. The problem is it has its own kind of logic, its own kind of givenness, because the other person, so in the phenomenology, let's say, of the heart, if we're talking about particular emotions, they're not going to have the same temporality, they're not going to have the same modes of possibility, they're not going to have the same relationship to otherness, and that means also, not everything is going to work as this constitutive duet that we find in the perceptual realm, that something appears as it's responding to my solicitation to usher it into appearance. I can't make another person reveal themselves, for example. And so I'm not saying, and I'm precisely not saying, that these other kinds of givenness have the same structure. That's what almost what Husserl wants, okay, in a qualified way, Husserl wants to say, I mean, it has to be qualified because he's trying to account how I can have a relationship with an object and has to borrow the structure of an objectivating act. And I'm saying, and that's what in the moral emotions, that there are different acts that simply don't have that structure. They're not borrowed from a perceptual realm. They don't have a noesis noema structure, although there is a structure of intentionality. And that means with that, we have to describe what kind of evidence is in play with that. What are the structures of it? So that it's not just a responding to my efforts, but I'm struck, for example, or there's all sorts of different ways in which that's been articulated in the religious dimensions in the Abrahamic tradition, but also in the interpersonal ethical spheres. The descriptions of those and the experiences of those kinds of evidences have a different quality than a noesis and Wema structure. But that means they also have the same problem. They have different problems, but they have problems of illusion or self-delusion or self-deception or all sorts of, it doesn't mean that every time I experience something or someone, that it's all clear. But we don't have that in a perceptual realm either. So I would say, yes, there is a problem. I don't know if it's the problem totally of error in a certain realm. It might be the problem of deception. It might be the problem of hating. The terminology changes. You know, it's not just, deceiving another. These have moral implications as well that are different from error. So that's how I would, I don't know the question exactly, but I would say, yes, there is a problem. There is a problem, but there's a problem of modalizations. But they're not necessarily a problem of error.
I have this is in a way a follow-up with this question. I did like the question, although it is a little bit like strange. I did like the question because what I wanted to ask you is, well, it's two short questions. First, it's about the very concept of phenomenology. I have the impression that you overemphasize just one part of this word, which is the part that belongs to phenomenon. And then what happened with the logic? And this is precisely, this is a part of the follow-up. So phenomenology, and this is also the reason I remain Husserlian, is that Husserl had a very strong commitment with reason. We can understand reason in a very broad sense, and I have the impression, I want to believe, you still remain Husserlian, at least at this point, since you still want to speak about evidence, but your notion of evidence, it seems to me that overemphasizes this, the phenomenical part of evidence. And what happens with this other part, where Husserl wanted to give account with reasons, in the space of reasons, not only of what we see, but we see this, and I can give account with discourse about what is given. This is also one of the reasons Husserl, I mean, of course, this is something we don't agree, of course, your criticism to this, the Husserl's emphasis in presentation regarding emotional acts, but the reason, I mean, in your speech is something like, okay, Husserl is just wrong regarding this. No, he's not. He's not wrong because what he wanted to emphasize is the importance of correctness or rightness, rightfulness, I don't know how to translate this, regarding the emotions. So the emotions are not only the way we apprehend values, but this also belongs to a certain right, to a certain sense of correctness, which reveals the rationality of such acts, which is the part I am not sure where you exactly are regarding this part. Okay, we can agree with Heidegger criticisms to the objectifying acts of Husserl. Okay, whatever. The thing is that Husserl emphasized this point because he wanted to make critical statements, and he wanted to perform a rational criticism regarding our evaluations. And this is the part I struggle to see in your position. And my second question is shorter. What is critical about this generative phenomenology? Because, I don't know, I also struggle to see this dimension of critical phenomenology. I do like this critical phenomenology. I agree with you in this part. So phenomenology was already critical in Husserl. All this, I don't know how to say this, this fashion of critical phenomenology, which I like, but of course it was already in Husserl. And this is precisely what I want to emphasize. I can understand why it is critical in Husserl, but I cannot understand yet why it is critical, the generative phenomenology, because it is clear that it's not Husserl, but your generative phenomenology. I want to understand in which regard your generative phenomenology is critical. Thanks.
Okay, so Ignacio, those are... So the second, I think, is actually more difficult. It's not easy, but... No, I don't know, but look, yes, I don't know. It's not easy either. But, you know, we can, I don't know if we should just, these are just two perspectives, and it's like, you know, I don't know if we're going to have a meeting ground on it or not. Yes, there is one attempt to make reason so broad that it no longer means reason. Or, here's at least what I'm trying to evoke here, is that there is a tradition to which Husserl seems to me to be wedded. And that, okay, I know he has descriptions of these things, and there's, you know, later texts, and there are, you know, and he's, okay. But nevertheless, which is a tradition of modernity, and that has to do with the, with a novel dualism, we can call that now, or let's say distinction, between reason and sensibility. And so that the, at least, I'm not saying Husserl did this, but it's already in, it's a tradition in which the emotions, feeling, were deprived of a spiritual content and were tossed, I know you know this, but I'll just read it, were tossed on the side of sensibility, or in order to have meaning, had to become rational, rationally justified. Trust is an excellent example of this, and we see this also coming up in the analytic tradition, in which trust sometimes gets interpreted as doing a risk analysis. This is another way of saying that, well, trust is blind belief, and in order to justify, we have to rule out risk, which, as you know, the fundamental character of trusting is not naivete, which would require perhaps giving an account, but vulnerability. So I can't exclude vulnerability in order then to trust. I would be negating the very act in which I'm executing in order to try to execute it. So I don't think that that Husserl's structure and in the structure of rationality accounts for something like that. That, however, is not to say that there is not a peculiar cognition, insighting, dimension in trusting that belongs to the dimension of spirit. That's not either blind belief or instinct or sensibility or just out on a whim. That's just one example. So the attempt is really to reclaim another dimension that belongs to spirit that is not susceptible to the same kind of rationality. There's nothing wrong with reason, but it's just not of the same kind. It doesn't have its same logic. I mean, if, I know, but if you would, I mean, I'm trying to reach for another term, which would be a kind of cognition. And rather than, you know, yes, there is an epistemic cognition that relies on reason, rationale, and so on and so on. But there's another kind of cognition that has a spiritual dimension, spirit, dimension of person, that we have, since modernity, excluded, except for some who have focused on it or trying to bring that in. And that's why I don't want to say that ology is so restrictive. Yes, one can say, oh, you're still dealing with logic, and logic is rational, you're doing phenomenology, otherwise it's not. And then I pose that question, you know, in what sense is phenomenology? To what extent is it even a phenomenon? You could say, if it doesn't appear within the structure of presentation, is it really a phenomenon? I mean, that interpretation leaves us only with certain kind of limit phenomena, and the most we can say is that this is experienced as not being able to be experienced, period. Okay. But I don't live, for example, if I, you know, in that movement of loving or trusting, it's not that this is a cultural object that I'm experiencing. And it's not an absence. Yeah, from a perspective of how an object is given, it is absence. But it's not absence in the sense of the internal experience of the other person or other beings other than human. So I would say that it is, I'm not trying to broaden it. I think phenomenology inherently already broadened. And there's a nearsightedness on our part and a prejudice on our part that restricts phenomenology to that one kind of description and that one kind of giving an account. Because there are, in fact, other ways of giving an account like in the tradition of the Abrahamic and the mystics, not just them, but also you always have a confessor. It's an interpersonal one. Or the historicity, the efficacy of those experiences historically that give evidence. Are they the kind of evidence that's like once and for all, you know, or no? But I don't even know if a perceptual act gives us that. Now, there is a virtue, certainly, to give an account and to see, are there confirmations of experiences? Yeah, I would say yes, but they take on a different tenor. And that tenor does have a structure. And to that extent, it has a kind of logic. But it's not susceptible to that same kind of epistemic. Giving an account of that kind of experience outside of itself, we have to appeal to inside of itself to see what that. And if you're not inside that experience or that realm of experiencing, then it's not accessible. But it doesn't mean it's not accessible, though. So I'm happy with them being. I mean, not that that matters, but I mean, there are the structures of rational evidence and adjudication, but there is also other ones that have their own validity, which is not a type of trying to make that under the particular umbrella of that sense of reason. I think I might go on too long with the aspect of the critical, but it has to do with the perspective in which the natural attitude is seen as natural attitude, and that movement that is that ushers in or that becomes a phenomenological reflection is that's all how that's that's with us within generativity. Only it's not that I ever get a final stand on that critical posture because it's still trying to give an account in that sense of the appearing and even my situatedness within generativity in its multiple ways. And that's not a matter of simply taking it for granted. But the question then is, is there a motivation for that movement? That's, I think, the more fundamental question. Can we pinpoint a motivation for that movement in the natural attitude to account for the natural attitude? I don't think so.
Una última pregunta. Quizás en el chat.
Hay una en el chat. Esta está en inglés, así que mejor. Dice, bueno, no tiene, es anónima. Dice, what relation would generative phenomenology have with metaphysics, taking into account Schiller's stratification of emotional life and his understanding of the first contact with reality as resistance?
With reality as resistance?
Yes.
Okay. So, generative phenomenology becomes, I think, metaphysical phenomenology. Because it's not because of the encounter of reality as resistance, but because of the dimension of that radical opening to the sense of metaphysics in this metaphysical in the sense that it is an orientation to and a becoming within all reality, basically. And so that's what I, so insofar, let me put it this way, as phenomenology is open to this other dimension of spirit as loving, which is not simply restricted to human acts, and broaches this realm, this entire different realm or different realms or dimensions of experience. It's metaphysical, but that I don't mean speculative. But certainly we become situated within, we find ourselves situated within it, and articulating or clarifying it, which also is a responsibility for its own, its generation. And that is not a mere act phenomenology. So I would say, and matter of fact, I've been calling it like metaphysical. I don't even know if, I just want to call it phenomenology, but I think it's metaphysical. I'm happy with, actually, I think that's also very provocative, so I think it's more interesting to call it metaphysical phenomenology. But it's phenomenology. So I would make a distinction. I wouldn't call it a phenomenological metaphysics. That is weird. Also, I would call what I'm doing, in distinction to like Richard Carney, we always have this debate, where he says what he's doing is a phenomenological hermeneutics. So the emphasis on hermeneutics. And I would say it's a hermeneutical phenomenology, if you wanted to use that term, because the ultimate court of appeal there is evidence. Or, sorry, experience. And what we're trying to clarify, it's a modification or development of phenomenology and not the other way around. So let's call it metaphysical phenomenology. Okay. Thank you.
Muchas gracias. Thank you very much. Ahora es el tiempo de disfrutar un vino de honor que los espera afuera. We can have a drink outside. Okay, great.